This is Thursday.
Thursday. It's still Thursday.
The first Thursday of Faye Frye's life outside of the womb, as they say.
Mm-hmm.
How long was Lauren in labor? Oh, wait, no, it was C-section. Wait, I don't know. Landon.
Landon, can you hear us?
Hello. Look at that smug look on his face.
Oh, that's funny.
Well, Landon was going to introduce the episode, but now it's less compelling since he's here the whole time. So...
Do you want to call someone else?
Yeah.
Should we just call Rachel again?
Well, I did warn her that we might call her, so...
Done. Call her. Okay. Call her.
Okay.
Landon, put your note cards away. It's not your turn.
What's Rachel's number? Someone got it.
217.
I got it. It's calling. See, this is what happened. The speech guys, we used to call people, and now people don't answer anymore. So now we introduce episodes by just leaving voicemails. Enjoy the show. No, I should say cue the music.
Call. You think Eric would introduce it?
Verdine? No, yeah. He's busy. He needs warning. And it's 10 o'clock there, so. Okay.
Ugh. I'm out of ideas then. Landon was my idea.
Final bell. Okay, here we go. Ross is leading off. The new speech series, speeches that got someone killed. Ross, what do we got? Lead-off hitter.
So lead-off hitter for this quad, we are going to a speech by Jesus of Nazareth, the Sermon on the Mount. Going into the Bible.
Can you introduce who Jesus is?
I think that's enough. Can we just listen to it? I feel like that's enough.
I didn't nail it. Let's go ahead and take a listen to that clip.
Matthew. Rabbi. I've got it.
The opening?
Yes.
What is it?
A map.
The what?
Directions. Where people should look to find me.
Rabbi?
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. For they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. rejoice and be glad. For your reward will be great in heaven.
Yes. But how is it the map?
If someone wants to find me, those are the groups they should look for.
And then?
You are the salt of the earth.
Okay, I wish I could say the first time I remember hearing the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, but afraid I don't. But in reading them here, listening to them here, just for clarity, the clip we just listened to was Jonathan Rumi's portrayal of Jesus in the film The Chosen. Yeah, I think that they're a good speech, if you will, to pick by Jesus. Because I think, you know, if you were to, and we'll get into this more later, you know, if you were to, you know, sort of wrestle verbally with someone who just thought Jesus was irrelevant in the modern age, or maybe they're a little bit nihilistic, or just anti-Christian, it's done nothing but harm. It would be difficult for them, I feel like, to reckon in a genuine way with the Beatitudes, right? You know, they might argue that, well, there actually is no true Christian, you know, like Nietzsche said, right? But seeing this content of this speech, you know, how I feel is like, man, they're so genuine. Like, how can you say that they are just some sort of fraudulent attempt at power by some group of people 2,000 years ago? And I think it makes for an interesting jumping off point to sort of navigate the rest of Scripture. I think maybe an interesting in-Scripture parallel that makes sense to me is, you know, a lot of people, you know, struggle with sort of the violence of the Old Testament, right? And I know Bishop Barron has said something like, read the Old Testament through, you know, through Jesus, essentially. He uses more poetic terms, but it's like everything has to make sense through the nature of Jesus, right? His mercy, his forgiveness, his non-violentness. And I think if you keep that in mind, even if you can't parse out the details, you can sort of have a certain confidence, if that makes sense. So same way with the Beatitudes here. It gives you a confidence that Christianity can't just be this power-hungry monster that some people might portray it as. And yeah, so that's those are sort of things that initially on my mind with that read.
I think, I would say the most I've interacted with the Sermon on the Mount is usually in bits and pieces or in chunks. Like you'll hear an excerpt from that at Mass, you know, here or there, or in just some sort of... yeah, quoted here or there. Maybe, you know, I'll read a few sections one time while I'm praying and then, you know, get to the rest of it later on. You know, so it had been a long time since I had, like, really read it start to finish. Yep, 5, 6, 7, all, you know, 3 chapters of this, like, consecutive sermon. And I don't know if this is true, but I would imagine it's the longest consecutive dialogue that Jesus gave in the Gospels. I would venture to guess that, at least. I don't recall anything longer, just because a lot of it, his interactions are based on actions, like he healed someone and talks to him, you know. It's more dialogue, I guess, than this is like his one big speech, kind of, so to speak. So Anyhow, I guess just having interacted with it in that kind of new way, which I would encourage everyone to do, just to refresh their memories. The thing that stood out to me is just how challenging it is, and how, it's just like almost rapid fire, gut punch a little bit, in terms of like how it strikes you. And the Beatitudes are like a really beautiful and poetic way to start. And then it like kind of really, it gets pretty, heavy hitting, shortly thereafter. But, I guess that's kind of my take or initial reaction to kind of engaging with it this time around.
Yeah, I'll jump. I'll kind of do the pick the speech plus first reactions. First reaction to the speech, kind of like Matt had said. I've read the whole thing through before, but I think first reaction reading through this time, I think just a couple things. One, I did, kind of like I think Matt had said, like just the length does stick out a little bit, like if you're used to reading scripture or praying with it or whatnot. It goes on for, several chapters, and it's just a lot of content there. And then the other thing is, I do feel like there's a sense that some of it sounds kind of like nicey, but other parts of it like almost make you feel a little bit uncomfortable because you realize you're not living up to it fully. So I think that definitely jumped out to me like several times. It's like, need to think about that a little bit more, or, that's not, fun to hear because I know I don't do that as well as I should or whatnot. So I do feel like those are maybe some of my first reactions to reading it. As far as, I'll just jump in. So this was mine here to start off the quad speeches that got someone killed. And kind of like I was telling the guys, in show prep, I've been thinking for a while about how we have not done anything from the Bible. And no matter which way you cut it, whether you believe it's the Word of God or people that don't believe God even exists, like you can't argue or deny the relevance and influence that the Bible has had on the world. So I think that I've been thinking for a while when the opportunity presents itself, so I feel like we need to dig in there a little bit. And so when we decided to do the quad speeches that, I don't remember if we said it last, if it was speeches that killed someone or speeches that got someone killed or how we phrased it, but we'll say speeches that got someone killed. Just the kind of the idea that, Jesus, what he did disrupted the world and made people so uncomfortable and was so challenging that they literally killed him. To me, that was just an apt, chance to get into the Bible a little bit. And I believe you are right. I think this is his longest single discourse. And anytime you just search, just trying to prepare for the show a little bit, about the Sermon Mount, things pop up, Jesus's greatest sermon, and these type of things are kind of the headlines to all the videos that people try to make. So it also seems, go ahead.
Maybe can I pause on something that you said, briefly? You'd said that, what Jesus did changed the world. It's because, obviously you're insinuating, right, the Paschal mystery, which some people will argue the truth of all of that. But what can't be argued, right, is he definitely existed, and this body of the New Testament came into existence after that, compelled, thousands of martyrs in the church who all shared a similar new nature. Like that for me is, and I'd say from all historians, is like inarguable. And I find that really compelling and interesting. So anyway, hopefully that makes sense why I wanted to sort of parse that out a little bit.
No, absolutely. Definitely. And then, just that, like the influence that it's had on those people. But I was even trying to speak to just, the entire Western world, like how much of our, thought, and like I've heard people argue before that you should read the Bible simply because otherwise you're not going to understand a lot of Western literature, just because the amount of just references and what it draws from. But anyway, so, but I just felt like that, if we Landon likes to find the first of everything, you know, the first whatever speech we do. And I forget how we have described how our choices tend to have patterns. But I was like, man, if this is the single greatest speech from the single greatest book, it's probably worth talking about. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, I guess, different varying reasons kind of why I chose it. So we already did first reactions. Well, Landon was on, he's off, just so everyone knows in case it's awkward. Landon has had, his wife gave birth to their second child. So hopefully that makes sense based on our cheering when he arrived to the podcast tonight. But so hopefully he gets back on and can give some thoughts as well. But jumping right in then, I guess before we move too deep into the outline, I mean, Mike, you shared a little bit, you know, something that why it's compelling to you, and that I kind of like the word compelling. Matt, any? So we asked what first.
Well, maybe can backpedal a little bit here. Where does this speech emerge? Okay. Right, for someone who's unfamiliar with the New Testament, which is of course Jesus' life. You know, where does this emerge in Jesus' life?
All right. Yeah. So I'll do. I'll jump in. I'll give. Try to give the 90-second version, but. So, I feel like it's fair, kind of trying to place this speech in context, to look at kind of the socio-political, what's going on, and also like the religious, what's going on. So, Sermon on the Mount, obviously Jesus is roughly 30 years old or whatever, but so the Jewish people, the nation of, you know, Israel, is under Roman rule and occupation, but that's kind of just the latest of many occupiers. So as far back as, you know, not as far back as they can, I mean, they had knowledge of before, I guess, they were occupied, but for a long, long time, they had been persecuted, oppressed under foreign rule, whatnot. And then, so I feel like that's just a good kind of frame of mind to have, just the fact that this is an oppressed people right now by the Romans. And then, and we'll, I think it's fair to talk a little bit about the religious context of kind of the Jewish people at the time to better understand where Jesus is coming from. So Judaism, you know, has been around at this point, and it's, you know, this, to not talk about the entire Bible, but at least at this point in time, they have the law. So they're kind of set of rules and regulations for worship, for life, to manage their yearly calendar. It kind of, the law has power or influence on pretty much every aspect of Jewish life. So, you know, they have to do this before they do that, and they do this at this time of year, and there are a lot of rules. And that's, you know, so when people talk about the law, so the law that they lived by at the time was a very, there was a lot of rules and all these actions they had to do and whatnot. So that was a very, the, I don't know if I'd say the center point, but a very large part of Jewish life at the time. Fair?
Yeah, okay. Sure. Yep.
Yeah, so then Jesus is born, and I think part of why this speech was, I would say, radical. And even though I do think it's probably fair to say, like, this isn't the, it's not like this speech, he said it and then they killed him. Like, that's not how it happened. You know, they had other, there were, it was a multiple, there was multiple reasons why, ultimately Jesus was, executed. But I think this speech very much encapsulates a lot of the things he was teaching. So, and was very core to a lot of what he was trying to accomplish. So I feel like it's fair to tie it into the speeches they got someone killed. Just a couple points I think are fair to make, and I don't want to talk too much or get too technical or into this type of stuff, but just to kind of set the scene. So again, why the Jews would have been so taken aback by this particular sermon or speech. So I kind of mentioned the law earlier. So Moses receives the law from God on Mount Sinai. So he goes up the mountain to receive the law from God, and then he can share that with the people. And, you know, so this takes place on a mountain, the Sermon on the Mount. So in a lot of ways, in some ways, like, it's almost set up to show how Jesus is the new Moses. So Moses goes up on the mountain to give the law to the people, or receive the law from God. So Jesus goes up the mountain to give the new law to the people. So it's setting up as the new Moses. And then the other thing that I think is fair, I mean, I didn't notice this initially at all, but just trying to read about it, just even how he phrases so many things. So if people read through the Sermon on the Mount, you'll hear the phrase, "You have heard it said, but I say to you," is often Jesus' word. So "you have heard it said" is pretty directly just referencing the Torah or the law. "You have heard it said." That's what the teaching was. "But I say to you," at least definitely from a Christian standpoint, but I think it's probably pretty easy to argue that that's Jesus claiming that he has equal authority to the law given on Mount Sinai. So he's claiming divinity, which is in itself part of why he got killed. And then last point is the Sermon on the Mount doesn't so much change, but you'll see he almost intensifies. You'll hear some people, I feel like it's easy to read it and say, oh, Jesus is just about love and forgiveness and meekness and the poor. But a lot of the things he says just takes what's written in the law and the law and kind of one ups it. So, you know, "You've heard it said that whoever commits adultery, but I say to you, whoever looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery," or, you know, whoever kills a man, "but I say to you." So in a lot of ways, he's just taking what's part of the law and trying to emphasize that it's not just about what you're doing, but it's so much deeper because it's actually how you feel. So it's taking the external actions and saying that's not actually what matters. It's what's internal and in your heart that actually is what's important, which, you know, can sound, some of the, like I said, the sermon can kind of sound a little bit easier, but in reality, when you look at it, like kind of like we said, it's actually much more challenging. But anyway, I feel like I've been talking for a little bit too long. So that's my context of this speech. So I don't know if anybody else has any other thoughts to add on that before we kind of move forward.
That sounds like the context. I think you got it there.
All right, so then we'll dive right in. So thoughts on, I think it's just to just try to get kind of conversation going. Thoughts of Jesus. So, you know, how he is portrayed in Christian circles, how he's portrayed in secular circles. Like, you know, if you guys went on the street and said, you know, "Jesus, who's Jesus?" Like, what do you think that, like, people would respond with?
I think most people wouldn't. You know, we were discussing this. He had in notes the domesticated Jesus, in contrast with the one that's certainly prompting his listeners to a profound challenge. And I think me and Matt both agreed that the domesticated Jesus is maybe more from 20 years ago. And I think most people now sort of see Jesus as irrelevant at best, and a harbinger of colonialism and racism, and, you know, any
what do you
sort
mean by
harbinger?
I guess I'm not super familiar with that word. Just, yeah, what do you like? He's a,
like, this both symbol and maybe they wouldn't necessarily be concerned whether or not he existed, but this symbol whose language is used, in order to amplify those voices, thoughts. Yeah. I think that's what most people would say, right? And just like something like useful to sort of think about, it's like that's being said in response to the vision of a Christian that's portrayed in, I hate using the term media, but that's the most logical word to use here is media, you know, people walking around in MAGA hats denying elections, and it's all these different things, right? Well, and being pro-life, I don't want to like be ogney. Like, there certain things are being portrayed which are good and true, sure. But it's also being portrayed with nonsense and yep. and sin as well, right? So it's, I think having that in mind kind of can make one more sympathetic to that recoiling of Jesus, because it's, yeah, sure. if you're not going to go read the Beatitudes, spend time with actual scripture, then it can make sense that you're going to, yeah, so I'll stop.
Yeah, there. I mean, I would agree. I would agree in terms of that's the kind of common version. I think there's definitely a specter of like the domesticated Jesus, or like I think Jesus is whoever the person you're asking wants him to be. I think might be the best way to like think, like what is like your, what would an American random American say about him? I think they would more or less just try to reflect their ideals in Jesus, or just outright like poop on him. I think that would kind of be what you would see. So I think you would find a decent number of people kind of doing like the 1990s domesticated Jesus, who's just all about love, man, you know, and that's what I'm all about, is just the love, and me and Jesus, like, we're tight. 'Cause like love, man, you know? And I mean, I think that still exists as like a decently common trope, but I think like Mike said, I think that is, has been surmounted, I think by a more complicated and diverse like response to that. But I think what you mentioned, like just about the heart, you referred to the heart as like this way that he is domesticated, you know, like, or like when like, oh, the things that what's going on in your heart is what really matters. And that's kind of a form of domestication. I think there's certainly a way you can read that as a domesticated kind of like hippie, sissy Jesus who's, you know, not trying to tiptoe around things. But like, I don't know, like if you, depends on what's going on in your heart. You know, I feel like your heart is if people are honest, their heart's much more of a battleground than it is a, you know, Grateful Dead concert, you know, with just peace and love. And, you know, I don't know. I think if something affecting your heart, I don't think makes it domesticated, in like a true sense. And maybe just like our modern sort of like stoic renditions of like masculinity has like rendered that maybe less appealing. But I don't know, like if you think, like read the Odyssey, like Odysseus is crying all over the place. You know what I mean? Like there are, you know, I think there are other cultures that were manly men were prone to their hearts, you know, like, or did show that. So maybe it's an artifact of maybe some like misguided stoicism too, but I don't know. I think this speech does encapsulate, I think, the totality of the heart, whether it's the times where you need mercy or the times where you need a kick in the pants.
Okay, let's parse that sure. out. Word of the night, parse. Where do you see in there a kick in the pants, and where in there do you see something that's the opposite that stick out to you?
One of the big kicks in the pants that, it's chapter 5, verse 37. Let what you say simply be yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. I just find myself always trying to like capture some nuance or like justify something or just kind of add more details that are necessary to my response to certain things. I'm scared sometimes to just say yes or no and just let the pieces fall, you know? and just to be honest about things and not mince my words or not like push in something in like uncertainty. I just find that really, really hard to do. Not that you don't be clear at certain times, but I think I way overdo just trying to like talk my way around or out of things instead of just like speaking plainly and from my heart and just honestly. I just find that really hard.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the word that I really didn't even know what means, and I'm not sure if a lot of people do, because I feel like it's always just used as a synonym for, I don't know what, but I mean integrity, right? It's you do what you say you're going to do, I think is under that umbrella. And I mean that, yeah, similar to what you're saying, Matt, I think that is a very adult virtue to grow into, because what can happen, you know, especially like with me, is like, well, I said I was going to, okay, not relevant because I don't have a yard anymore, but, and I'm not a kid, but I said I was going to cut the grass tonight. And it'd be very easy to get home late and say that, well, you know what, I'm going to have time to cut it tomorrow. And even if you actually do, there is inherent virtue in doing what you say you're going to do. It's an aspect of like being reliable, being predictable. Man, I wish I had come up with a more contemporary
example there. I was thinking about just with physical therapy, people often ask like what's going on and how long is it going to take to get better. I felt like as a new clinician, I felt like I needed to have a really smart answer and describe this and like add all of this like information and nuance and reasoning for the, and kind of like, yeah, just basically to cover my ass when I didn't know the answer, you know? I feel like as just with more experience and just more virtue and maturity, you come to know like, you know, this is what I know. This is what I don't know. I can't directly answer this question or that question, but this is kind of where I'm at and this is what I can offer you. And yeah, if you're on board, let's do it. If you're not, that's fine. You know, and I feel like grapple with just different like disagreements or situations where Claire and I like have different interpretations of communication that we've had, where it's like, I thought you said this. No, I said that, you know? I think those are situations where I'm challenged a lot with this as well. You know, like I said, I would do this, you know, am I trying to really twist this to give myself the benefit of the doubt at the expense of Claire? It's like, that's a real hard temptation sometimes.
Ross, did you have anything to add on that?
Just a small, I mean, I think it's not the same, but related. And I think to kind of bounce off, and I agreed like totally with what you guys are saying, but I think also, and it sounds similar, but I do think it's different. Like what you say yes to and what you say no to and the honesty of that. So like kind of Matt had said, like, if you don't know, being honest, but then like, yes, like if I say yes to something, like it's actually really important that I'm going to do it and follow through. So like I need to be not careful, but just like prudent with when I say yes to things, but being okay to saying no to things, if that makes sense. So, you know, if somebody asks me to do something and like I know I'm not going to be able to do it, don't like say yes and then try to squeeze it in and do a poor job and end up doing it late and apologizing, but just be honest and say no, I can't do that. But yeah, I guess it's just okay. Like I think I remember once reading, I think it's Men, Women, and the Mystery of Love, which is, I think Edward Sree wrote it, and I think it's like remembering correctly, it's like a simple down version of Love and Responsibility by John Paul II. And he talks about like the importance of if you say yes to something and then like something quote unquote better comes up, you need to stick to your original answer.
Right.
And I know that sounds like super like, okay, but most people, and myself included, like would probably struggle with that, you know, in the moment if something quote unquote better seems to pop up. But yeah, so that was my just thought, is, you know, is if your yes is going to mean yes and your no is going to mean no, you just need to be smart about when you say yes. But did you have something else, Mike, or do you want me to jump in with my this was my kick in the butt?
No, you can go with that. Sure.
My kick in the butt, still chapter 5, we're verses starting at 21. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. All right, sounds pretty basic. Verse 22. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. Mm. And just thinking about that, I'm just thinking about how many times does somebody say something to me that annoys me? And then the next like couple minutes, I'm just like thinking about honestly arguing with them. And like, you know, me being the smarter, better person in the argument. Or if somebody's driving silly, like, even if it's not, like, I'm not yelling and cursing and flipping them off, but just, like, where my thoughts go. You know, like, oh, that jerk, like, he cut me off or whatever. And just, like, how often, I guess I get angry with other people. And that impact, even in small ways, I guess, my mood. Or maybe I go tell someone else about the situation, even though like they can't actually do anything about it. So really I don't know if gossiping is the right word, but I think people would call it venting, I guess. But I think a lot of times venting is just, you know, self-permissible gossip, I guess. But anyway, so just thinking about that, like how hard we are on other people and how easily we jump to anger. And I should say I jump to anger not even the, you know, dramatic yelling, screaming, flipping them off, but just how I think about them or the thoughts that go through my head or that type of thing. And then, you know, hearing the words, the hell of fire, it's like, well, that's, you know, I need to not say I'm going to hell, but I definitely feel like I need to, you know, be more aware of this and do a better job at that.
I feel like this is one of many verses in this speech that are just when people talk about, I mean, we've talked about just the undeniable relevance. Like, you can't understand Western civilization without reading the Bible. Like, it's just a fundamental text that's just very important, whether you believe it's the Word of God or not, right? So, like, you just need to read it and understand at least a little bit of it, just to understand our world, at least half of the world, you know. But the, this just seems like such basic, like, conflict resolutions, you know, like, first of all, like, check your own heart, you know, like, kind of like we were getting at earlier, like, even if, you know, I think most people would agree that venting, like, I think most people would say, oh, you have to vent every now and then, otherwise if you bottle it up, and like, to some degree, that's true, like, that's kind of what this verse is talking about, like, you know, don't bottle it up until you explode, you know? But like when you confront your brother and sister, like you have to be, I mean, it's basically saying you have to be gentle about it, right? You can't just go in there insulting people, which maybe that's a biblical justification for political correctness. But I mean, I think there's something to that. You know, you don't want to, you shouldn't go in there insulting people if you're trying to reconcile with them. First, try your best to do that. And then from there, do your best after that, I guess, if they're not willing to reconcile or whatever, what have you. But like, I mean, that just seems like such a, like, just a helpful way to just think about anger and how to deal with it and how to, how to interact with people in the midst of anger. That it's like, gosh, like if you... Like those who say that Jesus is irrelevant, just I don't know. It's just that they clearly haven't read much.
It is an interesting thought. Like, you know, you can read the Bible. Maybe should read the Bible, right? Like, yep, this is the Word of God. This is Jesus. This is God incarnate. So like, we should do what He says. But I feel like there's also just like a practical, like if you look at it just from a human psychological standpoint. Like if somebody that didn't believe in Jesus or God or anything, but like just read this as like, let's just read it. It's like, it seems like, kind of like you said, it seems like that would just be like, oh, this is actually a pretty attractive just way to live, you know? It seems like there would be a lot of benefits if people tried, whether they believe in God or not, you know, whether they're Christians or not, if they tried to live by these standards that are laid out, or these rules or whatever you want to say, it seems like it would be hard to say that this doesn't seem to be like a good way to live, you know. But I guess I'd be interested to hear like a non-Christian talk about that, like read this and then, you know, not critiquing, you know, theology and, oh, you believe in God, blah, 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 but just like critique this as a way of life, you know. Oh, you should, you know, you shouldn't commit adultery. You also shouldn't lust after women. You shouldn't, you know, be a jerk and talk to people rude. Like, yeah, I know, and you could go on and on, but I would be interested to just hear that kind of that thought process.
Yeah, I mean, I think that I do want to go back to the anger at your brother and hate and such, but just to briefly comment on that, and this ties into, I don't know how much you guys listen to the Jordan Peterson, Matt Fred interview on Pints with Aquinas, but you know, I think most non-Christians who are going to genuinely listen to what you just said there on that point, Ross, I mean, I think they would like smile and nod and say, oh yeah, it sounds good. But, you know, I mean, unless you're going to make a real investment, and when I say investment, like really consider who Jesus was, I just don't think it's going to stick. And I think that point ties into that Jordan Peterson, Matt Fred interview. Did you guys listen to any of that?
I've only just gotten started, so like just 10 minutes. Like, yeah, I haven't gotten to any serious meat.
You know, and Matt Fred, to his credit, you know, towards the end, I suppose, really started grilling Jordan Peterson, you know, like, do you believe in God? And yeah, do you believe in the Judeo-Christian God and Jesus being God? And Jordan Peterson, I mean, he just slinked around and refused to answer it in just the basic way of yes or no. You know, he basically said, well, that's not the right question. It's about basically believing as if God, behaving as if God exists, believing as if Jesus is God, which... sure, I get what you're saying, but, and anyway, it seems like, at least for the most part, you know, Jordan Peterson lives a pretty Christian life, you know, but he obviously doesn't participate in the sacraments, but I don't think that's the case for most people. And there's an analogy, I think, here that's relevant that I think Matt shared at one podcast. It's like, you know, in many ways, I think Jordan Peterson is the Simon Sinek of Christians, right? It's like, oh, guys, you know, check out this Christian thing. Look, if you just, like, think about it this way, it's fantastic. It's best life ever. It's sort of like that in this very academic, intellectual way. But that's not exactly the gospel. What's really going to grab people, you know, by the heart, by the balls, in a sense, to put a certain intensity to it, is that guy in, or girl in India who's digging through garbage, their life is just rough, it's bad, but they haven't heard the gospel. Simon Sinek or Jordan Peterson is not going to be the thing for them.
Sure.
It's, right, it's the idea of the resurrected Lord and more than that. To tie all this back into Ross' initial thing, it's like, yeah, unless you take that step, it's just a nice idea, even if it is so logical, like Jordan Peterson portends. Yeah.
The heart and the balls. The Mike McTaffer story.
Yeah.
Maybe we should rename the speech.
So if you guys don't have any of that, I'll go back to the hate thing. I do definitely struggle with that a lot. And in this one, too, I think is one of the really... So for anyone following along in their Gideon Bible that they got for free while they were in college, you know, Ross is sort of expanding the Beatitudes. I suppose this is the whole sermon. I guess the whole chapter 5 of Matthew is the sermon. He didn't just stop the Beatitudes, but...
5, 6, and 7.
3 chapters,
man. Okay.
Just to be clear.
You know, I think that is one of the... It's a very disarming teaching. There's obviously no, like, power in it. Well, no obvious power, I suppose. The idea that, well, of course you don't kill. You know, there's a certain prudence to that. Obvious prudence. But the idea that you don't even entertain hate towards another. And this is something that I do personally, like, struggle with. I just confessed it yesterday. I remember. Where did we mention this? Because maybe I'll save this for later. I'll try it. Maybe we'll see the run of it here. Yeah, the idea, you know, how Jesus pairs hate with murder. Like, they're the same things in the same way that lusting after generally a woman, you know, as these things go, that's the same as adultery, sleeping with someone. And I think that there's a certain similarity or rhyming, if you will, or dark poetry, if you will. You know, we think of someone who kills, who murders. Well, they're not like us, right? And I was, trying to explain, I think, this beatitude this teaching to theology class once. Is like, how do you get to the point you kill someone? And most people, you know, you would never expect that they'd be the person. I mean, there are some psychopaths. It's like you see them and they're like, yep, that's probably someone who's going to murder
Ron
someone.
And tragically John.
Happens.
Ron and John.
But so many murders are just these things that emerge somewhat spontaneously, but there is a certain fertile ground of hate that's built up in someone, right? And there's a certain virtue in believing that you could be that person. Maybe a more obvious, intuitive example, you know, a buddy of mine, he shared how he doesn't do shots when he's out at a bar, not with his wife. Because he know, even though this guy is more virtuous than me, he knows that you can get caught up in a moment and make a really, really, really bad decision. Now, there's a lot of people would say, that's ridiculous. I love my wife. I would never cheat on them. Sometimes, not often, but sometimes, way more than zero, that's the guy who sleeps with some other woman and maybe ruins his life, potentially. And there's just... Yeah, there. I guess trying to package all this together, there's a certain humility in recognizing my hate can lead to actual murder. My lust can lead to actual adultery. One more thing, the Mars Hill reference. You know, I've said this before in the podcast, but I remember them saying at one point, you know, people who listen to this, Mars Hill wasn't exactly a cult, but maybe certain manifestations of it. They listened to that and like, how can you ever be so stupid to participate in that? Like, I would never join a cult or do anything like that. And the people who think that way are the ones who can sometimes end up in a cult. Because you're not, again, you're not like being humble. You're not considering that I could be the one who goes too far and gets caught up in whatever.
Yeah. I mean, Ross, I don't know if you mentioned it yet or if it was just the outline, but just the Bishop Barron kind of take on it. I mean, one comment he made... just about like the idea you mentioned, Mike, like, oh, I don't murder people. I'm a good person. You know, like I don't murder. I don't cheat on my spouse. I don't, you know, sell drugs to little kids. And, you know, like they list all the like the five worst things you could possibly do. But it's like, is that where we set the bar for a good price? You know what I mean? Like, yeah. And beyond, I mean, certainly, like, I'm on board with everything you said. And in terms of like the inner, the individual manifestations of this principle, but just even as a culture, it's like, well, gosh, like, I don't want, you know, if you were like, let's say you had a resume, a blind resume of a guy your daughter was dating. And it said, hasn't murdered anyone, hasn't cheated on a spouse yet.
Right.
Hasn't, you know, sold drugs to minor, you know, like just listed like the five, like pretty universally acceptable, terrible things. Like that tells you nothing about that person.
Mm.
You know what I mean? That tells you nothing as to like whether or not your daughter would want to marry him, whether he would be a good fit in your family, whether he would lead your daughter to something like noble and good and like. So just even on a bigger scale, I think it just begs the question, points out the question. It's like, we need to draw the line a lot earlier than we draw lines sometimes, right. You know?
Yeah.
And create this like hedge of protection around yourself.
I like that you said hedge of protection, because it's like, again, kind of talking about how Jesus gives us this way of living, and then it's like, really, we could, I mean, it's like, it's just good practical advice at the same time. Like, so you said, you know, you need to hedge yourself, right? Start, raise the bar, blah, 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 like, and then literally that's what he said. So, you know, so we were talking about, Mike, you mentioned like, you know, a guy at a bar drink too much, committing adultery. It's like right after he talks about adultery, he says, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And like, he doesn't literally mean cut your hand off. He means like, you have to do the necessary steps so that you won't become that guy, you know? And for a lot of people, that's, if my wife's not around, I can't drink I can't, you know, do shots or whatnot, or just because we could all become that guy. Three guys in 2024, just like, after 34 years of life, this is good practical advice. It's like, well, that's exactly what, you know, Jesus literally said that, you know, 2,000 years ago. Maybe we should have just listened to him, but.
Or we should conduct five scientifically organized empirical studies with Harvard professors to prove the same thing.
I don't know. I don't mind if you want to keep running with the examples. I feel like the anger one, I think, seems super practical because it's so like universally applicable.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting to think about real quick before we kind of move through the rest of it. I think sometimes it's fair and not, you can't put people on a pedestal, but like, I think it's fair to like hold up someone or just think of someone as like, who's doing this well, you know? And like, how can I be more like that person? Because I think if we get too abstract, or I don't know the right word for it, but, too abstract, I guess it can be kind of up in the clouds and hard to really implement into practical everyday life. You know, yet lets their yes mean yes. Like, they're not a pushover. You know, they're not a soft, they don't try to talk around it. They just, you know, in some ways, in some instances, they can seem stern, but at the same time, they are very merciful and they aren't losing their temper and they aren't gossiping and they aren't venting about humans, you know, just because they need to. And it's funny, like the first person that pops in my mind is my brother. I don't think anybody would describe him as soft. And I've heard him say some things before that's like, I could see that. I don't think offend is the right word, but like, I could see some people not liking that or being uncomfortable with that. Probably because they need to kind of take a little bit deeper look interiorly, you know? But at the same time, like, he's got a picture, or he's got a St. Augustine quote over his dinner table that says, like, I don't want to butcher it, but really close to the quote, it says, let no one speak ill of his brother at this table. Yeah, like, I am going to be, like, firm, but I'm absolutely not going to throw someone under the bus or gossip or vent or rage. And I think sometimes, it seems like sometimes in our venting, and maybe venting isn't the right word, but, like, when we get anger, we just want other people to be angry with us. I don't know if you guys ever have that experience. Pats us on the back or, you know, gives us permission to do it. And I feel like it takes like a strong person to say, like, to be able to toe the line between I'm going to be firm and stern, but I'm also going to be really merciful. How to do that well. So I don't know if that makes sense or not, but I feel like it's in my mind, like I picture people like that. It's like, yeah, like I would like to be more like that person.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's profoundly relevant for our times, and I find no evidence counter to the claim of Father Rob there, so no argument here. But yeah, being firm and merciful, I mean, I think that's the, you know, that's another way of articulating the exact virtues for our contemporary Western climate, right? Not atmospheric climate, but cultural climate. What I mean by that is I feel like there's such a culture of both subtle and not so subtle hate. The not so subtle hate is obvious enough. Yeah. I don't think we really need to spell that out, but the subtle hate, and maybe a better word for subtle hate is maybe a lack of just conscientious sympathy. So to make our podcast a little bit more relevant here, did you guys listen to the speech or any excerpts of Chiefs kicker Harrison? What's his face?
Butker. Yeah. I have not.
You did, yeah, Ross?
I read it. I mean, I didn't listen to it.
Yeah.
Is this a because I know he gave a speech a few years ago. It sounds like he gave a new one or more recent one. Okay. Yeah, I have not heard the recent one.
Yeah. Yeah, Benedictine. And I did listen to the full speech. And, you know, to put it very simply, briefly, the context and message of the speech goes something like this. You know, you're receiving these degrees today in order to make you capable, successful, professional world, which is great. But remember that you have a vocation, you know, as mom, dad, religious, and that matters more. But you're going to be challenged on that by the culture. That's great, good, true. But what I interpreted, there's these little subtle jabs that he makes throughout that I'm not saying that Harrison, what's-his-face, is a hateful person, but I felt like these were just subtle manifestations of hate, might be too strong of a word, but disgust, maybe is a better word, disgust for certain people in the cultural milieu. One fairly benign example, I think that's worth mentioning. He mentioned the lack of virtue, fortitude, strength, firmness of the United States bishops and priests. Well, one, I'm not sure that's super relevant to commencement speech since I don't think there's any bishops in the audience. We'll set that to the side, though. He did reference how, you know, you might be at a parish with priests who are more focused on Instagrams with their dogs and the perfect sweater. Now, I sort of understand what he's getting at, the criticism, but I find that sort of a subtle manifestation of hate and disgust. Maybe that'd be a good opportunity to talk with your parish priest, like with the imaging he's giving off or something like that, the optics of something. But in a commencement speech, I think it comes off as prideful and unsympathetic to this priest who maybe feels lonely in his life and, sure, you know, he's seeking a certain kind of attention in this way. I think that's sort of a good example of sort of subtle hate, disgust that can sort of creep into modern culture. Yeah. I was trying to riff on Ross's sense of necessity for firmness and mercy. Sure. Maybe I'll tie it all together as well. Father Rob wouldn't say something like that. And he wouldn't. I mean, he wouldn't, in all honesty.
And I want to get into one more thing, and I feel like we're kind of approaching that final third of the episode, but in a super practical example, and I feel like this is kind of the, and this was not intentional, but I'm glad it happened. Like, I feel like this kind of gossipy or anger or hate seems to be kind of running through, like, you know, we all resonated with a little bit. I don't want to look too much into this because I don't want to, like, overanalyze it, or I know certain people, and they're not religious people by any means, and I bet they're good people. Like, they're just kind of, they're, I feel like, a slightly above average American as far as morality and ethics. But when I notice them sometimes, like, talking, gossiping, talking, you know, just venting, but, like, over the line a little bit, clearly, you know, you're talking poorly about another human, and, like, I'm sure they had reasons for the way they did the thing, and it's more complicated than you're presenting it, and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, I can sense them trying to get to suck me into that conversation or to tearing that person down.
Sure.
And sometimes, and this is where I don't want to overanalyze it because I don't want to become prideful, but I do feel like there's a sense of, like, they know I'm the quote unquote Catholic person. So it's like, it's almost like if they can get me to consent to it, it, like, makes it not less bad, but, like, it's like if you're doing something and the people around you are clearly against it, like, you're going to question a little bit if it's appropriate, you know, if me and Matt are just pounding shots and Mike's not, eventually we're going to start questioning if we're drinking too much. Just like in common communal atmospheres, workplaces is probably the most common. Like, it's actually a pretty, it can be kind of hard to navigate, like, out of that situation, you know, because it's like, I don't know this person super well, and there's six other people around, so I don't think it's appropriate to, like, in that immediate instance, to be like, hey, shut up, you know, don't talk bad about such and so-and-so. But, like, I also don't want to be, like, talk around it soft, like we talked about earlier, like, and I don't, so I do feel like there are, like, practical, just, that's actually kind of difficult to navigate, to actually be the firm yet merciful person.
I mean, yeah, I mean, that would depend so much on the situation and the people involved. It would, yeah, I mean, that much, it would just have to be a prudent discernment. And
sounds pretty soft, Matt.
Something.
It depends, I guess.
Quote scripture in their face and don't let them forget.
You are being condemned to the hell of fire.
That's right. Jesus does reference throwing people into hell a lot in this.
Yeah.
Stretch.
Sorry, I didn't mean to shoot you down, Matt. I was trying to be kind of, I was being comical.
But yeah, no, I mean, that's...
Now you're being a-y. Stand by.
Yeah, let your yes mean yes, Ross. Fight what me. Are you doing? Come
on. That actually is sort of a thing. When people don't stand by their joke, I sort of get annoyed.
Yeah, when you over-explain your joke. Well, honestly... All right, don't podcast scared. So Ross and I are physical therapists. Most of our office are women. Women do that all the time. They never just let a joke and just let it sit. Like, they always like, oh, but just kidding. Yeah. Like, you're great. Like, I love, you know what I mean? Like, that's,
yeah.
It's just how, like, so I've, like, I definitely have developed that habit.
I stand by my joke.
Yeah, no, it's a real thing.
You know, and you know, there is something to that because, well,
oh wait, I take it back then.
when a joke doesn't land, right? For whatever reason, there is a certain virtue in just moving on. You have no need to defend your humor or whatever. Sometimes people just don't laugh, and that's just how it is, and you don't need to investigate why. There is something I think very, very adult about that.
Okay, these are the, and again, the sermon is not super long, so if anybody hasn't read it, please read it, because I mean, I could read this on seven different days and might have seven different parts of it stick out to me or strike me. So yeah, put that aside. But everything I feel like thus far has been very directly like, oh, what did Jesus say here that, you know, kind of challenged us? But I do think it's also fair to think about, so again, speeches that got someone killed. So Jesus was this radical figure. And I mean, yeah, we didn't maybe talk about that we talked about it enough, but so to the point where not this sermon, but his entire life and what he taught and what he did, I mean, he literally got crucified. So pretty challenging figure to certain people, yeah, if they're going to crucify you. So again, not trying to look too much at the sermon specifically in terms of, oh, what passage or what verse really sticks out, but just the idea more of just challenging people radically, whether it's us challenging people or people challenging us. Just so I think that's, and again, it's similar, but I feel like it's a little bit different because it's not just, we're not quoting a book anymore. We're not quoting the Bible. We're not quoting Jesus, but you know, instances where it's like, hey, yeah, so-and-so is acting in a certain way and I need to say something, or someone has said something to me and it doesn't even have, I guess, and this is what I spoke a little bit in the show prep, like, it doesn't even have to be this guy was being a jerk, so I called him out, or I was being a jerk, so he called me out. But maybe just, you know, this person was living in such a way that I realized I need to do it differently. So this, you know, I guess it can be the direct confrontational verbiage or just more of a witness lifestyle that is attractive or, you know, challenging in a way. So can you guys, I just feel like that's it's related, but I feel like it's different enough that it might be worth approaching a little bit of this idea of, you know, we would all agree that there's plenty of problems in the world and whatnot. So like, how do we challenge radically or allow ourselves to be challenged radically, the way that Jesus did, to where, you know, they nailed him on a cross and killed him. So that was kind of my final kind of thought on the whole episode.
Well, what would be your final bell then?
I don't have a final bell.
Okay.
I don't have an actual final bell question. I feel like that's pretty broad for a final bell though.
Yeah, like, no, I agree.
It can be as specific as like, yeah, Mike cleaning up the campsite makes me think I should recycle, or Andy Meister tell me I'm a jackass, I need to forgive that person, maybe I should do that. You know, like it can be specific, or like, I don't know, I just feel like it's too broad to be a final bell.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah, topic of being challenged and challenging others in specific and specific concrete direct ways. I think that is something that I'm definitely grateful and I do attribute or give a lot of credit to FOCUS, Fellowship of Catholic University Students in College, right? Because, and I mean, I think that the reason that street cred got there is because, you know, you are in close relationships that are informed by scripture, the church, right? And a couple of things, that I'm fine, comfortable sharing. You know, especially early in college, to some extent still now, maybe I go too far sometimes, but I just had a really, really rough mouth. Now, mind you, I still don't, but I never used, like, the Lord's name in vain. Like, I took a lot of pride in that, probably too much pride. But I was like, what? It's not a sin to say f***. So I would just use it belligerently and offended mothers, grandmothers, uncles, cousins, everyone. And I sent an email out to some friends trying to organize a thing, and a couple of focus missionaries were on the email as well, so they obviously read it. And Mitch Menarik, shout out to Mitch Menarik, read the email, and he said something, you know, just to the effect of me, like, you don't talk like that, especially on an email to women. And granted, it was being, like, playful and fun to whatever extent that counts. But
Very little. It counts very little.
Yeah, very little. Fair enough. Yeah. But, like, yeah, it definitely helped register for me. There is something to coarseness of language, which is not always appropriate. And, you know, it's like, yeah, Mitch was not super confrontational about it. He was confrontational enough. He was direct. It was to me. It wasn't a focus talk that he mentioned, and I was like, scratching my chin. Maybe that's me. No, it was to me. It was based upon something I specifically did. Right, and that gives you that echoes that kind of thing, and that thing that echoes in such powerful ways beyond that moment. Because then it just, you realize that, wow, you are being watched. Your language, your behaviors do have real consequences. And man, what else am I maybe doing? Right. What was the other example that I was going to share? Yeah, Danny, Father McShane, he said something sort of similar once. This wasn't like, okay, this is what we did. This were a fun anecdote. I remember me and him, we were driving somewhere when I was in graduate school, and I said, let's do this. Let's ask each other what our best quality is about the other person and what our worst quality is. Very bold question, man, for road trip fodder. I remember Danny said my best quality. He says I'm really funny. Worst quality, he said that the way I talk to women sometimes. That was sort of similar to Mitch, but a little bit more on the nose. That definitely affected, how he communicated with me. Not recognizing, certain elegance in women that I should have. So, bottom line, yeah, there is a lot to be said for direct confrontation, among friends. I don't want to run with this topic too much, but so then it made you think about, what about non-friends? I'm probably known as the guy at the climbing gym who calls people out all the time. And what it is, it's very, I mean, I think you guys, so you can plug your phone, your music into the speakers, right? For not the whole gym, but like the lifting area. And, you know, there's a sign for it, but people will still play music that's utterly inappropriate with kids that walk through that space with either or earth that comes up. What's interesting, everyone has all, no, once it was like, he wasn't big on what I said, but most of the time there's a tremendous sense of like a weight being lifted and a freedom just in that room. Maybe I just imagine it, but that's how it feels. Just a tremendous freedom and liberation and comfortability that wasn't there before. So
I know I've been surprised in the past at times, because it is scary to like throw that out there to someone, especially. So I think the gym setting where it's like, you don't know the person as well. You know, yeah, that would be especially like you're putting yourself out there. But it is surprising sometimes how well that's received. And how often other people have your back, but we're just like not quite ready to say it. I can think of a time. So there is, so Ultimate Frisbee Team in college was about to, we were going to get like new, we weren't even going to get jerseys. We were just going to get like, we were kind of between team names. There's this whole drama behind it, whatever. But this one guy wanted to make this like Ultimate Frisbee t-shirt with some sort of dirty joke on it. I can't remember what the joke was, but it was just some dirty joke. And it's just like, you could tell no one was excited about it, but no one was really going to push back that hard. And I was just like, and that was where I was just like, dude, like, I don't want to wear this in front of my family. Like, I don't want to wear this out in a store where a little kid's going to see, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to wear this anything where other than just that turn, you know, and I shouldn't wear it even then. Like, it's just not a good thing. Like, why are we doing this? There was no one who voted on that being like a shirt design, and it was just an interesting experiment, because I felt very Yeah, I was like, crap, I'm gonna be like isolated, or are people gonna, think I'm the weirdo prude on the Frisbee team? And like, yeah, it is remarkable sometimes how often people have your back with that. But I guess kind of similar era, I was living with some college roommates who shared a house, and they hung this poster of just like a girl in like a swim, like bikini or something. And there, yeah, it there are some other jokes kind of made on, in post-it note form on the poster, what have you. But it was the type of thing, it's like, in a, you kind of, ex I mean, at me as a college kid, I was like, oh, that happened in college dorm rooms. I wouldn't do it, but my roommates did it, whatever. And Andy Meister, whom I'm sure to no one's surprise, ripped me a new one on that, in terms of allowing, and it's true. It's like, yeah, I live there too. Like, why can't I say what I think about that? That it's, yeah, classless and demeaning, and I don't want to look at that. And it's not good for me or anyone here, and just to say it. And yeah, they took it down. Like, it was, yeah, it was one of those things that, it is unbelievable sometimes just how, how much power that has, when it happens to you, like when Andy Meister like ripped me a new one for it. But then also just like when you kind of share that, like just put that out there, yeah, like that boldness is rewarded, whether you're the giving or giver or receiver. I think as long as it's founded in the truth.
First funny thought. I only have a few instances of being ripped a new one in my life.
Andy Meister was at the center of
Three come
several.
to mind, and Meister was two of the three. That's just kind of funny. Maybe we should have him. I should have
Oh,
called him for
dude.
the, we should call him for the intro sometime.
Yeah, that would be good.
That'd be good. But yeah, I mean, I feel like to share, I feel like I don't want to just, beat a dead horse with stories, but yeah, I mean, I feel like I have my own instances of people calling me out. But like as awkward as they were, always appreciated. So I think maybe a slight different spin before we go to the final bell then. So I can think of twice where I tried to call someone else out though. And one of the times I think I did it very immaturely. Like I was right in what I was saying, don't get me wrong. But there was a little bit too much of a like beat my chest, and maybe a little bit to like tie it back to what we said earlier, like explaining your own joke, like need to. I'm really looking for approval. You know what I'm saying? So it was in front of a group of guys, and I feel like I was almost looking for the other guy's approval more than like truly looking out for the person I was calling out. In my defense, I guess it was like a spur of the moment. Like it wasn't like a planned, oh, I need to talk about such and such. But like looking at it and like analyzing it later, it's like, yeah, I said everything. Like what I said was totally true, but I was too concerned with, what other people thought of me as opposed to just the other person's welfare. So I was not, like the Sermon on the Mount tells you, going to the person directly. And then one other instance I can recall, somebody was just really speaking very poorly, of women sexually. And it finally did get to the point where, like, I remember I kind of like had a one-on-one and talked to him about it. And I honestly don't know how it was received. It was definitely the kind of like awkward, they didn't put up a fight, but they also weren't like thankful. And I really don't know. I'd be interested to talk to the person about it now. I don't know. We're not super close, so I don't know if it'd be a good conversation or not, but.
Hey, Ross, Matt's right here. Let's Matt, tell us.
Just gonna let that joke hang. You're mad.
I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, okay? Final bell.
Ding, 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 ding.
All your strength. All your power, all your love.
Where is it? 15. One more round. There's no stopping us now. This is our round. Don't stop it now. We're starting, we don't stop. All your strength, all your power, all your love, everything you've got. This is your whole life here. Do it now.
And we're back. Ross, what do we got? Bring us home to Friday in 93 more minutes.
So despite 3 chapters of content and timeless wisdom and all these sayings. It seems like we've really all grabbed hold of the anger and how we speak about other people and confronting other people, firm yet merciful, having, and we didn't use these words, but I think it's, you know, Baron said it's accurate. We need to have incredibly high standards and yet incredibly infinite mercy at the same time, and be able to walk both of those at the same time. So to bring it home, I feel like my final bell would be, you know, what is the thing that people do that you talk around or beat around the bush, but you really just need to call them out for? And then how many of you are thinking about one of the speech guys? That's like a fun second. Don't podcast scared. To give you guys some time to mull on the question. Something I need to call people, honestly, not even like, and the more we've talked tonight, I feel inspired to not even like redirect, but just to confront directly. Complaining about our boss. If we have coworkers listening, I'm not even sorry. You need to do better. Like, I feel like so often, like, groups of people get together and they start complaining. And my thoughts usually go to something to the effect of, like, I see what you're saying because I'm annoyed as well. But, like, at the same time, like, we're not in that position. We don't have to make those type of decisions. And I've thought about this a lot, and I usually try to go with the redirect route. And it might not even be like change the conversation. It might be like, yeah, but like, I don't know. I just feel like maybe I'm trying to be too much of a peacemaker, but not in like a true peacemaker, more of just like a, let's stop this from happening in a gossipy way, as opposed to just like saying, you know, like, you know what, like they're probably doing their best. So I don't know if we should talk about them like that. You know, it would probably just end the conversation slightly awkwardly and maybe make him think twice about it next time. But
I mean, work settings are one, that's where I spend a lot of time during the week, of course, but also it's a situation where usually the topics aren't ultra personal and things you wouldn't, you know, you can share publicly. But I would say similar thing, but just complaining about, I don't know. Oh yeah, I guess this one might be more personal, but it drives me up a wall when people complain about their spouse in a really uncharitable way. Mm-hmm. Where they're like, oh, can you believe what my husband did this weekend or and just in a really, where it's just like, are you guys on the same team or not? You know? And it's just, and that's something that, I mean, there's a few coworkers who are like, I respect really, like, I really respect these individuals in a lot of ways. And sometimes like, those are the ones that hurt the most, you know, when it's like, gosh, like I really do think you're like an awesome person and I really enjoy working with you and you've got all these like virtues, but it's like, take it easy on your spouse for a second, you know? And, I guess that might be one thing where it's like, that requires a little bit more. I mean, complaining about patients, complaining about bosses I think that might, that's a pretty universal thing that I can and should do, but I think maybe and you need to be more prudent with talking about more personal issues like that with someone. But that is one thing that that I think is worth mentioning, and actually something that a coworker of mine, Mike Holloway, Ross and I's PT classmate, has called himself out on. It's just how he talks about his kids, and how he like complains about different kids scenarios. And it's one thing to talk about, oh gosh, you know, like my teenager's in this really rough phase, you know, this is what's happening. And in terms of like discussing it with a fellow parent, right. There's a way you can talk about that, but then there's a way where you're just like, gosh, my kids are terrible, you know, and where it's this, just overtly negative. And I guess one of his students was like, gosh, well, I'm never going to have kids. Like they just kind of said it very casually. And Mike was like, Shoot, like, I love the kids. Like, what have I done? You know, like I hope my student has kids. Like, and he's a great guy. Like, and he would be the first one to admit, like, just to share like this sort of story. So I don't think it's oversharing, but because like he is a great father and he does love his kids. And and like he does a lot of things really well. And yeah, he himself admitted it, and it's something I certainly think about. Just having him like share that story with like students and coworkers several times. And
I'm just gonna follow that string of thought and call myself out on something. I think I might. I give up on people too easily. It's very easy for me to be incredulous at what I perceive as underperforming behaviors. And yeah, I think it can maybe make me a little bit nihilistic. Yeah, that's not a great final bell answer. That's all I got at this point.
So your final bell answer is, I'm a jackass.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, just spelling it out.
Right.
Well, I guess I'm up next. What do we got for speeches that kills? Yeah, well, I think I'd mention maybe a George W. Bush speech after 9/11. I don't know. I'll see if I come with something else I like. But until then, thanks for drinking.
And thinking.
With us.
Hey, be safe out there, will ya? And do all those beatitudes.
Dead ends come and go. Look toward the horizon. Up ahead, you'll find a peace of mind, relief from the trying. I have burned a bridge, wrecked in a ditch, had to ask forgiveness. Dead ends come and go. Look toward the horizon. Oh, there are stories to tell. The times we grew and the times we fell. Oh, I've been afraid some days, but the road will lead us to a better place. The road will lead us to a better place. Oh,